CHGO White Sox Podcast coming to you live from Studio A of our CHGO offices here in the West Loop of Chicago. I'm your host, Sean Anderson. Alongside me is Herb Lawrence,
who has
two thumbs.
Yeah, I was seeing if that worked again.
You know that is only Vinny's thing that does that.
Yeah, but remember the little blooms came up?
Right, but what I'm trying to tell you is that only Vinny has that power.
So it's like I have no power to do that?
You have no power to do that. You are not in the box.
Son of a bitch.
The only Alice in Chains told you, only the man in the box can make the balloons appear. When Vinnie Duber joins us later, he can give us two big thumbs up from Arizona and tell us all about those balloons and the screens effect.
I think the peace sign also does something.
Maybe. That's Herb Lawrence.
Hello.
I'm Sean Anderson. You can follow me at Sean_W_Anderson. You can follow Herb at Eckerwall23. You can follow the show at CHGO_White Sox. We got Kevin Wells producing us
Boys,
today.
What's going on? It's been a while.
It's been a while. That's
glad to
also
be here with you.
A 90s song. Been a while.
Been a while.
Yeah, there you go. Make sure you hit the thumbs up button and make sure you're subscribing to the CHGO Sports YouTube channel.
I don't know.
Who?
Silverchair. Soul Decision.
Silverchair, you made that one up.
That's a real group.
Really?
Soul Decision. I don't know. I'm
it's
just
stained.
Guessing 90. Stained.
Stained.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're not great.
Yeah, you pull out your best stained t-shirt. Is that a joke?
No. I mean, okay. There's people on a milk carton right now.
Okay.
I can't find them.
Every time I come on this show, I start singing 90s grunge or something or classic rock. And I don't know. Vinny brings it out of me.
Sing a good 90s
grunge. We were singing Green Day the last time. I don't know.
Stained is terrible.
Were you singing Green Day last time?
Yeah, we were singing Green Day for something. I don't remember what it was about.
I don't think that's true, Kevin. I think you're remembering.
Were you being an American
happened.
Idiot?
I promise it happened. I promise.
What?
Were you being an American idiot?
No.
Were you trying to hitch a ride?
That's
what we were. Yes, that was it. We were hitching a ride. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what it was.
Great song.
Thanks, Herb. Appreciate it.
On today's show, we will be talking to Greg Hinz of Crain's Chicago Business about the 78 Project and his exclusive published article on his hour-long lunch with Jerry Reinsdorf. We got 10 minutes of Greg's thoughts after that lunch, so we're excited for you to hear that. And then Vinny will be joining us from Arizona after we play that Greg Hinz interview to talk about Ethan Katz's recent comments. He made some comments on Garrett Crochet, Michael Kopech, and my guy, Jordan Leisure. So we'll hear about what Eric Katz, that's a completely different guy, Ethan Katz, had to say about those three pitchers. And we will wrap on Oscar Colás. Does Oscar Colás have a chance to make this White Sox team after 2023 didn't go so well? We got an excited Pedro Grifol talking about Oscar Colás, and we're excited for you to hear that. But let's get into the 78 Project right away. Herb and I, we have a lot of passionate feelings. We ended that show pretty heated, pretty tough. You were ready for the White Sox to move to Nashville. I was adamantly against that. How do you feel right now? You ready for them to move to Nashville still?
Any second.
Okay.
Like, bye. Don't threaten me with a good time.
You will lose your job. NSHV.
I'll find another one.
Okay. All right. Well, let's go to Greg Hinz. He has...
I love this job, but if they lose, I mean, I'll find another one.
He's had his job at Crain's Chicago Business since 1996. So this is a man with a ton of resources, a ton of connections, and he started to tell me, at least with this interview, and you could check out Greg's interview. You could follow him at Greg Hinz on Twitter, and then you can check out the actual article over at chicagobusiness.com where the exclusive interview is published. You will have to pay for that exclusive, but it's an outlet that's well worth it.
Support journalism, local journalism especially.
And Greg Hinz started off telling me why Jerry Reinsdorf is starting these seismic moves right now.
The team isn't very happy at Guaranteed Rate Field. Haven't been happy for a long time for a variety of reasons that we can go into. And their lease expires now 4 or 5 years down the road, which means if you're going to consider serious options, now's the time to do it because you can't build a stadium in 10 minutes. I think another thing on his mind is frankly, his own mortality. which he's kind of laid on the table when I had lunch with him. He said, "Hey, I'm going to be 88 in a few days. I'm not going to be here forever." He didn't say it, but I think the death of his running buddy and partner, Rocky Wirtz, who owned the Blackhawks, has to weigh heavily on him. And I'll take him at his word. He says, "Hey, if I'm dead, the team is probably going to be sold by my heirs and the other investors after I go, and it probably won't stay in Chicago. And therefore, if you want to keep it in Chicago, we kind of have to make it more valuable and more presentable and tie it down legally. And the best way to do that is a new stadium that the taxpayers would pay for with a long-term lease."
Right. So I think most people are trying to understand that long-term lease and how maybe the Bears figure out first, what did you sense the current relationship between the Bears and White Sox being? Is it an active relationship that these two are at least communicating? I know Jerry didn't want to elaborate too much.
I think the relationship at the moment is they're competing for the same pot of money. There's this little agency called the Illinois Sports Facilities Authority that nobody's ever heard of, but it's the agency that built Guaranteed Rate 30 years ago or so, and which renovated Soldier Field for the Bears. And their source of income for the most part is revenues from a hotel tax on Chicago hotels that yields $60-65 million a year. Both teams are eyeing that, and I'm not sure there's enough money to go around for one of them, much less both of them. So they started talking, and I suspect what they're talking about is, well, how can we make the pot bigger, maybe get some other revenues or whatever, but they don't want to be, they're in a position, if they all get together and present a united plan and go down to Springfield and City Hall, they might get somewhere, but if they look like they're fighting, they'll probably kill each other.
Right, and they probably need both Brandon Johnson and J.B. Pritzker on their side. I know Brandon Johnson just had comments recently about giving sports teams public money, and I know J.B. Pritzker, at least recently, has been somewhat against it, but has said as long as there's a viable plan to create revenue, he might be for it. If you had to give a temperature from, we'll go Celsius, even though we're in a Fahrenheit country, 0 to 100, where would you put the temperature of the likelihood of them securing that public subsidiary or subsidy?
I think the likelihood that they're going to try is pretty high. Whether they get it or not, it's a little too early to tell. There's no credible argument that the Bears are going to leave this metropolitan Chicago area and move out of state. That just ain't going to happen. So the question then is, what's the value to the city of Chicago of having them in town and playing at Soldier Field or somewhere around Soldier Field? In this case, they're looking at the parking lots just to the south, as opposed to out in Arlington Heights. The team seemed to be all gung-ho about Arlington Heights. They've changed, perhaps because they've had a change in management with Kevin Warren coming in as team president. As for the White Sox, they haven't presented a very good team on the field. They're not. Their popularity could be a lot better than it is. They have a harder case to make. But the question ultimately will boil down to the politicians want to be blamed for, you let the White Sox leave, or you let the Bears leave. And if not, are they willing to come up with the political support for taxes that won't be very popular? Now, I would add that the plan as described by Reinsdorf doesn't involve any new taxes. The taxes that already exist. The hotel tax is there, and it ain't disappearing, however much the hotel guys would like it to. And the sales tax that he's talking about is a stopgap. That's already there, too. So at the moment, they can say, hey, we just want to redirect existing money. We don't want new taxes, but it's clearly going into their pockets.
But extending that bond for 30 to 35 years, right? So keep the existing taxes, but just extend its life form to make up for that money.
Renew it and extend it. Because okay. you can get, if you have for 30 years to pay it off, you can get it's like your house. You owe $20,000 now, but the note is due in 5 years. But if you want $100,000 for this and $200,000 for that, well, you get a half a million dollar mortgage and you pay it over 30 years. It makes it much easier.
Right. And then you talk about Jerry and the product on the field. He mentioned that, you know, public money would be good for the team. You see in 2021 after COVID, 19,000 fans per game, and they won the division. Then the next year, nearly 25,000 people per game. It seemed like the stadium was fine. It seemed like people were coming to the stadium because the product on the field was good. But then obviously the product started to take a turn. Like, I'm trying to really make a sense of his tone when he's talking about the product on the field is dependent on the stadium and the place where they're playing baseball.
I hear you. First, let me stipulate that having a good product is always important. This is show biz. This is entertainment. People don't want to go see a team that's going to roll over and be out of it by the bottom of the third. So, you know, and to the extent he hasn't been able to put that together, that's on his plate. It's his fault, and he needs to do something about it. And they've tried, but it just hasn't worked. To another degree, though, sports fans, and you see this all over the country, are looking for a little bit more now. If you view a ballpark as part of an entertainment area, where there's restaurants and bars and nightlife and other things around it, look at what the Ricketts have done up around Wrigley Field. And they've paid for all the renovations of the field themselves, but they've also put a lot of money into surrounding stuff. People feel safer if you're in a crowd. They can stick around for 3 or 4 hours afterwards and, you know, not be worried they're going to get shot up. If you go down to Guaranteed Rate Field on a day when they're not playing, you can shoot a cannon through there. There's nobody there. There's no neighborhood there. It's just a sea of empty parking lots. Now, he's the one who built it that way 30 years ago. It's maybe his fault. But he says that looking at Camden Yards and looking at Minnesota and other, looking at Denver and other places that have built new stadiums, we need to have a different paradigm here. And he says that only that new paradigm is going to give him the kind of money income that he needs to go out and really compete for top free agents, which is half the game in baseball these days. You know more about it than I do, but if you can't compete for the best players, you ain't going to win.
They're trying. They're not trying to sign, you know, those best players, but they're trying to maybe create them as best as they can. With related Midwest in this property, the 78, is it alluring enough? Is it the most alluring spot that will gain that public money for Jerry? Do you feel like they had the most successful bid that Jerry could then sell to, you know, the governor and mayor on why they need public money for this specific spot?
I think the 78 site is a good site. Just south of the loop. It's at Roosevelt and Clark Street. If you look south, it's essentially never been developed. There were some warehouses and rail yards there that were pretty much torn out 50, 60 years ago, but it's pretty close to raw land right in the middle of the city. It's close to the expressways. The Ryan is just there, the Kennedy's there. It's not too far from Lakeshore Drive. There's a Metro stop. They're talking about putting a CTA, L stop, or subway stop there. And it's close to hotels. It's close to a lot of restaurants and other kinds of nightlife stuff that already is in Chicago. So yeah, I don't know if there's, I suppose you gotta get, there's a better site somewhere, but this one is pretty good. It has a lot of potential if it's developed the right way.
So if this doesn't go right, they don't get this public support, do you think there's a compromise on Jerry's price tag? Do you think there's going to have to be some compromise, especially as you mentioned, the Bears and the Sox are fighting for that same pot? When he comes out with this certain price tag, how much do you think he's willing to give if, you know, maybe the end goal is just to get any public money at all?
Jerry Reinsdorf has, for good reason, a reputation of being a shrewd bargainer who knows how to get the maximum stuff from whoever he's the other side of the table. I have to assume this is a bargaining position, that they're willing to bargain. I've yet to see him put a bunch of his money on the table, but he's got a lot of money to do it. The fact of the matter is, although he says they're going to invest in other parts of the 78 development, the stadium itself will be built strictly by taxpayers. I'm not sure that's saleable in this political environment. You know, how about belling up to the bar, Jerry, and putting $200 or $300 million bucks of your own money in there?
Why not, Jerry? Why not pony up and pay a little bit? Thank you, Greg Hinz, for his time. At Greg Hinz is where you can follow him over on Twitter. And again, you could read that exclusive interview at chicagobusiness.com. Thank you again to Greg Hinz of Crain Chicago Business for joining us. Herb, what'd you make of the 10 minutes with Greg? What did you make of the article now that we've had time to digest and read it? What do you think of the 78 Project?
I'm a fan of Jerry doing what he usually does. Like he... While I, as a fan of the White Sox, don't like him trying to get this money from us, the taxpayers, I understand why he's doing it. As Greg said there, he's a shrewd businessman. I think he came up as a real estate lawyer. He knows what he wants to do. He's done this before, where the current ballpark is 33 years old. He got that stadium from pretty much blackballing and blackmailing the state of Illinois and his friend Big Jim Thompson. No more Big Jim Thompson anymore. And as Greg said at the end, I don't know if the political and the social hunger for paying for a billionaire's stadium is out there like it was back then. And the threat of moving, as I said before, when he's like, would you want them to go to Nashville? I was like, yes. If that's what they want to do, I'm not going to sit here and beg him to stay. And definitely not going to have him take the money that could be used in other places. And I'm not going to be one of those people who get on here and get on my soapbox and say, well, they could be using it for schools. Well, they could be using it for this, that, and the other. Because I don't usually do that. So I won't start it and just bring up an argument just to oppose Jerry. But that money can be used in other ways. And if Jerry really wants to have his legacy and really, really wants to have White Sox fans secure that this team's going to stay in Chicago, put some of your own money down. Most of your money down. I'm sure White Sox fans would be like, hey, man, we'll meet you. Or Chicagoans, we'll meet you at a 70-30 split. You pay 70% of the ballpark, we'll pay 30. It would not be fine with me. But at least that's something. You're at least giving of yourself, who's listed as a 2.4 billionaire, to build your own stadium and to have your legacy as such. Right now, he's doing nothing but alienating fans like us and then also bringing up cities like Nashville as if that threat is going to be credible to us and like we care that he's going to move to Nashville or the new owners.
Well, but that's the thing. It's like he's not. Like I
or the new owners. Bye.
I'm really getting the sense that it's Jerry Reinsdorf's final move is either he's getting a new stadium or he's not. And if they don't get a new stadium, he's just saying that, and as Greg said, there's no legality keeping the White Sox here. So if they build a new stadium, you'll be able to extend the life of the White Sox for sure, for certainty, give you that you know, peace.
And the thing is, he can do that easily with his money or go and get a loan. And passing that on to the new owners. And if the new owners come into Chicago and say, no, F that world-class city, 7-time Condé Nast best big city in America, let's move to Nashville or Salt Lake City or Portland, Oregon. Are we listening to those cities as opposed to Chicago? Are we listening? Like, Chicago, you guys live in this city. You understand how great the city is. I don't care who comes in. If that person is from Nashville, if that person's from Portland or Salt Lake City, they get to Chicago and be like, why would I leave this great metropolis for question marks that are going to not be the solution to my answers?
Well, and I think it's Mutajaba Ali. I don't know if I've said that correctly.
Boom.
I don't know. My eyes hurt. Will incentives based or in performances be good options, meaning instead of giving them all the money up front, it should be based on a discount for fans? I don't think that's a bad idea, but I do find it funny because I was doing some research to talk to Greg Hinz so I didn't feel stupid, and there was a piece in NBC 5 from 2010, and it was talking about the Cubs getting denied the $200 million for Wrigley Field and how Greg said, you know, the Ricketts themselves ponied up that money, built out that entire stadium. But in 2010, they were like, why don't they get the money once they win a World Series? 6 years later, after they made all the renovations, they did. So, I mean, hey, spending the money and making the commitment to Chicago was not a bad investment from the Cubs. So maybe the Sox would learn something from that. Brandon Johnson, mayor of Chicago, said yesterday, as far as financing these projects, both organizations know that they have to put some skin in the game. They're expressing a commitment to do that. As far as public dollars, we haven't gotten into any of those specifics yet, but I will say that we're going to explore all options, but we have to make sure that we're doing right by the people of Chicago. Everything is on the table, but again, I want to make sure there is a real commitment to public use and public benefit. So I have no idea what is going to happen.
Word salad.
Yeah, but a big word salad there. He wants to be as vague as possible, yep, just so he can have some negotiation tactics when Jerry comes to him with hat in hand and begging for money. I hope Brandon Johnson people already don't like Brandon Johnson. This is political suicide. You give public money to a billionaire. Any of these legislators who do this, everybody's going to remember at the polls. So tread lightly. People are not willing to be doing this, especially for such a detestable owner like Jerry Reinsdorf.
And Shy Bros Football saying, do not go to Sox games. We're going to take a break after this. Force him to sell. He's selling. He's about to turn 88 in 3 days, and that's the whole point of the Greg Hinz interview. What he's expressing is his mortality is, he's very aware of his mortality. He's aware that, you know, not a lot of people live past 78, let alone make it to 88. So, it doesn't mean that Jerry Reinsdorf is going to be passing soon. We know Virginia McCaskey has lasted all the way to 100 and is still going. Like, it's not a guarantee that Jerry Reinsdorf would die in the next 5 years, but if I had to bet, I would absolutely think that the White Sox have new owners within the next 5 years because, again, that article says they're shovel-ready. They want to start building this year. So, like, I don't know if that's going to happen, but also, like, if they are building a new stadium, they're approaching a new home. Like, that's when people will be interested in buying the team. And, again, he's approaching just older and older and older. He's not getting younger.
Yeah, he could go the Mike Ilitch way where the Tigers owner said, I'm going to die soon, and I'm going to push all my chips in. It didn't work out necessarily. They didn't win any championships. But I guarantee you go to Detroit, bring up the name Mike Ilitch, everybody's like, yeah, what a great owner. When Jerry does pass, he will have a bad reputation here. And his legacy will be terrible from us White Sox fans, from people like Matt Peck and the Bulls fans. His name will be tarnished here. I would think if you see your mortality, you would want to leave something for the fans that you're supposed to be serving.
Well, I you're right, and I hopefully he does cough up his own money to make this commitment.
Can't take it with you.
No, you cannot. It would be great to see, and I think especially just it does seem like he's trying to secure a future. Like I know we're not supposed to give Jerry Reinsdorf any credit, but like it does seem like at least that second point that he's making, like, hey, you build a stadium, the White Sox are here forever. I know it's also just benefiting his wallet, but let's just take.
I just think that's a lie because the White Sox will be here forever.
Will they?
Yes.
I don't know. I don't know about that. I don't know how big the market share and how much that affects people. I don't know. I don't have billions of dollars. Let's tell you about our friends over at Prize Picks. Prize Picks always delivers. They're a fantastic and fun app to download. They're the largest daily fantasy sports platform in North America, and they are the easy and most exciting way to play DFS. It's just you against the numbers. Instead of battling thousands of other players, including pros and sharks, you pick more than or less than on 2-6 player stat projections and watch the winnings roll in. It is a very fun way to watch the game. I know Herb's been playing it. I've been playing it. I got two entries tonight, and it's very simple. You can make these entries in under a minute, truly. Yep. There's games tonight. I believe the Bulls are playing tonight.
Bulls are playing the Celtics.
Okay, so you can go and pick either more or less than on a Bulls prop or a Celtics prop. I'm going with Tyrese Halliburton, Jalen Duren, and Jalen Brunson tonight. I'm also going to go a little bit of college, a little Zach Edey and John L. Davis. So if you do want to try out our friends over at Prize Picks, head over to prizepicks.com/CHGO and use code CHGO for a first deposit match up to $100. That's prizepicks.com/CHGO and use code CHGO. Daily fantasy sports made easy.
And I want to tell you about the guy that was in our studios and today, Thursday. He was in our studios on Tuesday. It still smells like bacon.
Respectfully stunk up the joint.
Which is never a bad thing. And Charlie the Bacon Guy is based out of Woodridge, Illinois. He makes craft bacon and bacon jams for over 35 different flavors. Bacon and bacon jams are naturally cured, preservative-free products. No ingredients that Charlie cannot pronounce himself involved in the process. Unlike most store-bought bacon. And Charlie put these words in here so I can... You know, ethereobate or sodium or acerbate.
Nailed it.
For example, those are not in Charlie's bacon. That's in other store-bought bacon. They're vacuum sealed and freezes perfectly. Bacon lasts in the package for up to 60 days in the fridge or 1 week after the seal is broken and 9 months in the fridge. Bacon jam lasts about 90 days in the fridge and up to 1 year in the freezer. But if you're keeping your bacon jam in the freezer that long, you're doing it wrong. Check out awesome merch for Charlie the Bacon Guy. Beanies, hats, t-shirts, stickers, and coffee mugs. The other day, Charlie, when he did come in, he brought my order into me from there. I got the Cajun, I got the raspberry chipotle, I got the Maui Wowie, and the bacon I tried the other day, chili lime. I'll tell you what. But he has other flavors like maple pepper, chorizo, French toast, honey chipotle, jardinera. And bacon jams. I got one of the bacon jams, just the original one, because I wanted to, you know, dip my toe into it. Mercy, I tell you what, delicious. But they also got bourbon, mango habanero, cherry jalapeno. The bacon jam goes perfectly in anything. Put them on scrambled eggs, toast, with or without jelly, crackers, burgers, grilled cheese, charcuterie boards, cinnamon rolls, pizza, or Charlie's favorite, the spoon. The Bacon Vault, it's got all the flavors he's made in the past. If it's not currently available, give Charlie about 2 weeks, and I'll make it for you. Starting now, you could save 10% on your order at charliethebaconguy.com when you use the code CHGO, which I did use the other day, at checkout. You can pick it up, which is the most efficient way for you, or he can deliver it to you or meet you at halfway. Even ship it. He makes the bacon so you can bring it home.
And you could head over to charliethebaconguy.com. That's his website to go place your order. Mm-hmm. All right, let's head out to Vinnie Duber, who has been patiently
thank you, waiting. Vinnie.
Thank you very much, Vinny. We appreciate that. And before we jump in, we do want to thank our friends over at Gila River Resort and Casino. They are accommodating our friend Vinnie Duber right now with the lovely accommodations over at Gila River Resort and Casino, V-Kiva. So how you doing, Vinny?
Doing good. How are you guys today?
Oh, not too bad. Let's start off with, I guess, the breaking news, if it's urgent enough to call it that. How's John Brebbia doing?
I mean, he's not doing as well as he was a couple days ago, I guess. He's got a right calf strain that he suffered in yesterday's live batting practice session. He looks like he's maybe doing a little worse than he is, actually. He's rolling around the facility on one of them little scooter deals, but the White Sox aren't describing it as such a terrible thing that, you know, usually is accompanied by one of those things. They say that the expectation is he'll be ready for opening day. Right now, they're not going to push him in games, but they say that he still can throw. But they're not going to put him into games just yet, and they hope that he's ready for the start of the season. So this obviously was, you know, I hate to call it one of the bigger acquisitions of the season, but when you look at the bullpen specifically, one of the only two major league free agent deals that were signed for that relief corps with him and Tim Hill. You know, I've been talking the last week or so about how basically every spot in that bullpen besides those two are complete mysteries, and now one of those two, probably the most significant injury in camp so far. Obviously, that speaks well to this general health of the White Sox. They haven't really had any health issues that they're dealing with before this happened to John Brebbia. The other day, we did hear that Edgar Navarro, who did pitch in the majors last year, but mostly a minor league reliever, needed Tommy John surgery. And today we heard that Shane Drohan, who was, if you'll remember, the team's Rule 5 draft pick during the winter meetings, he had shoulder surgery today. I wouldn't imagine that he will be in the mix anytime soon to make an appearance with the big league team.
So just to follow up on Drohan, yeah. I don't know if you know this, but I'm going to ask you. I'll be bold here. How does that affect the Rule 5? Because I know if he doesn't make the opening day roster, typically he'd have to be sent back to the Red Sox. If he's placed on the injured list, does he get a grace period with the White Sox where they're able to possibly test him out on the major league roster? What's the situation with Drohan and that Rule 5 situation?
I do not know the rule book, okay. But I would assume that you know, just like anything else, you put a guy on the 40 or you put a guy in the 60-day IL, he's on the 40-man roster, or rather he's not on the 40-man roster. So, I mean, they could clear that 40-man roster spot and keep him, you know, on the injured list, I guess. You know, like it would make sense to me that he could technically be on the quote-unquote active roster, even though he's on the IL. So I don't know. I would think that if he is on the IL for a lengthy period of time, they basically could keep him, I would imagine. But, well, but I yeah, don't have know you, the rule book.
Have you guys, did you know that if you use the play, it's called a Google. Google actually has the ability to Google the MLB rule book, and it says a Rule 5 draft pick can be placed on the Major League injured list, but he must be active for a minimum of 90 days to avoid being subject to the aforementioned roster restriction in the next campaign. So I guess maybe if it's shoulder surgery and he's, you know, facing 90 plus days on the IL, the White Sox will be able to at least keep him. So I guess I should have Googled that before I asked.
And I think also the White Sox can work out a deal if it comes to that. Right. With the Red Sox to just keep Shane Drouin on the Major League roster for their team and then send him back to the minor leagues if need be. With the Rule 5 draft just straight up and down, he needs to be on that 40-man. So, I'm, you know, it's sad because the White Sox, you know, have already started with three injuries, all to their pitching staff. But as we have talked about before, it seems like Chris Getz, Ethan Katz, others, and Brian Bannister have fortified this relief corps, so those losses won't be too tough, and it seems like John Brebbia's injury is just a small passing thing, and Shane Drouin wasn't necessarily depended on this year. So I'm kind of, you know, sad that, you know, these people are going to be out for a little bit because it's White Sox. It's starting to get your mind to think, oh, God, here we go again. But I think they've done enough with the floor, so you're not losing too much of major league experience when they do come and break camp on March 28th.
Absolutely, and then no.
Yeah,
go ahead.
I saw some of those reactions that were similar to yours there, Herbs. And listen, every team deals with injuries, obviously, at this time of year. And certainly, I don't think the White Sox are in the worst spot, you know, by a long shot. I mean, we dedicated an entire conversation last week to what the Orioles are going through in their starting rotation. We're talking about one guy who was supposed to be a pretty big part of their bullpen, but that might be ready for opening day anyway. And then two guys who really were very much toward the bottom of the list, in my opinion, on whether they were going to make the team. So certainly Shane Drouin had some other stuff with him being a Rule 5 pick. But, you know, if you were talking about him maybe making the rotation, I don't really think that ever look to be in the cards, you know, if you're just asking my opinion. I don't think anybody should be freaking out over, you know, these spring training injuries. I think that for the most part, the White Sox are experiencing very good health at the moment.
Yeah, you mentioned the Orioles, and I mean, today the Mets put Kodai Senga on the IL. So, hey, it could be worse. And Brebbia, too, I guess it is a little bit of a concern because you look at 2017, 2018, 2019, before COVID, 50 games, 45 games, 66 games, missed the 2020 season. And then in 2021, only 18 games, 2022, 76 games, and then last year, 40 games. So it does seem post-COVID that he has been running into, you know, situations where he hasn't been able to pitch. Hopefully that's not something that continues to linger and affect him. Maybe it's just a flare-up as these guys start to ramp up, and hopefully we see Brebbia soon. Because, as you mentioned, you don't want to put too much emphasis on the signing, but just monetarily, one of the larger signings for the White Sox in John Brebbia. So let's move to a guy that's not in the rotation. Let's go to one of these outfielders. It did seem in the audio that you sent to me, Pedro Grifols seems to be pretty amped about the work the White Sox have done so far, huh?
Yeah, I mean, you guys were poking fun at the whole fast thing yesterday, and we'll see if it ends up that it deserves to be poked fun at. But as of right now, he's thrilled with this whole playing differently thing. And obviously, it's a goal. He hasn't done any of it yet. They haven't even played a spring training game yet. But he is thrilled with just the chance to try it. Because last year he saw his team play in a style that he didn't like. And obviously the results were not to his liking. And listen, we could tell that, right? I mean, we were talking about it throughout last summer, how, you know, it really seemed like the fact that they were bad was really getting to him and really making him upset. And here we are in spring, where, you know, the cliche is everybody's record goes back to 0-0, and all of a sudden, boy, it sure is nice to not have 101 losses, right? I mean, like the idea that he's a much more bubbly guy or a much more excited guy right now is certainly true. And I think you can chalk a lot of that up to comfort. Listen, last year it was, you know, the introduction, right? It was his first year, not just with this organization, but ever doing this job. And, you know, I think he was probably trying to impress and probably feeling some pressure and, you know, wanted to make a good impression. And it was the exact opposite of that. And so now he's been around this organization for a while. He's done this job before for a season. And you can just tell that he's far more comfortable, be it in his interactions with us or the way he's approaching things on the field. I mean, listen, how did we hear him say that he approached that clubhouse last year? He wanted to take a little bit of a hands-off approach, let the guys who had been here for a while do it. And to be fair, it's the exact same approach that Tony La Russa took a couple years earlier when he took over. But Pedro Grifol had it go really sideways on him really quick. Perhaps part of that new method is, okay, I know that didn't work. Now I'm going to take control, and I can feel more comfortable taking control because these people know me. I'm more established in this organization and in this job. I really do think and sense that he is just very comfortable now. And like you said, very excited. You can tell he's very excited to see this team play in a way that he probably likes a lot more.
And Vinny, you've been great in getting some good coverage down there. If you're not following Vinnie Duber down there in spring training, you're doing it wrong, at Vinnie Duber. One of the things I saw yesterday was the fundamentals they're getting back to and the sliding drill that they had in the pitcher. I think it was Yoan, Luis, and Eloy Jimenez. I love it. It's awesome. But I was just wondering if Pedro gave insight into, or anybody, why they had their shoes off. Because I'm a fan of, you know, playing how you practice. And if you're only practicing without shoes, I don't know what it is.
Herb, I have spent the last 36 hours being bombarded with Twitter replies. I don't know why this, of everything I've ever tweeted, has the most reach of everything. But everybody's mad. Nobody is happy that the White Sox were doing a sliding drill for any number of reasons. Listen, they do this every spring. They do sliding drills every year, all the time. They always use a mat because they don't want the guys tearing up their leg or anything like that. They always take their shoes off because the cleat is going to tear up the mat. This is how they do it. And I apologize, I guess, for not providing that context. But folks on social media thought that this was some sort of, a brand new thing that no baseball team has ever done before. I'm seeing, how can a pro athlete be still having to practice this? This is something that should be taught in Little League. It is taught in Little League. All this stuff is taught in Little League, and they still have to practice it all the time. That's how you become a professional. None of this was out of the ordinary. You can critique the sliding ability of the various players who were filmed doing it to your heart's desire, I suppose. But this is nothing out of the ordinary, and I'm sure it's happening at every single camp across baseball.
But the reason why is because the White Sox are a fundamentally unsound team. So that's why it up.
They were. But, I mean, they've done this before and been bad at that. You know what I mean? And now they're doing it, and they're hoping that they are not bad at it. You know, certainly part of Pedro's whole thing that I was just talking about is to do those little things better, you know, to stop making the mistakes in every little facet of the game that we saw them do over the last 2 years, right? I mean, certainly Chris Getz had an emphasis on the defensive part of that with his acquisitions, but they're talking about it in base running and hitting and pitching and every little thing, too. You know, I think last year I did I had a similar video with a similar thing where they were practicing the calling for pop-ups, right? Between the second baseman and the out and the right fielder, or the shortstop and the left fielder. And everybody online was, you know, what you just did. Oh my God, I can't believe they're finally doing this, or oh, how they have to do this because they're so bad and no other team has to do this. Every team does this all the time. The point, though, obviously, the difference that you pointed out is that they haven't been successful at those things once the regular season comes along. They're hoping that changes, but this is the same thing that happens every spring.
They are the ones who created FAST, and the F in FAST is fearless. Seems are pretty fearful of injuries, fearful of the players hitting their cleats on the bag, which it seems like. And it's the opposite of what they're going for. That's what I'm saying. Like, as I said, you play how you practice. And if they're not playing without their shoes on. So I get the shoes on, get on the dirt, and do it right. Because then when it comes to game time, you're not to have the conditions that are right. That's all I had to say. I'm just harping on things that they say. They want to be fast, and they want to be aggressive. But they're, like, half-assing into second base.
No, you're completely making things up. I think you're being ridiculous personally on this front. And you're not alone. The entirety of Twitter is as well. So, but again, I think this is just a drill, right? And it is something that happens every year. And I get why you're upset, because you've seen them play in the regular season and they screw up all the time. But this is just a regular old run-of-the-mill spring drill.
Well, I guess, too, we saw that pop-up drill, and we were like, oh, well, Elvis Andrus is playing second base. This is going to be great. And then we see, even late in September, Elvis Andrus and Oscar Colás having issues with fly balls where the second baseman and right fielder should be communicating. Like, they can practice all they want. It's just about the consistency throughout the season as well. I don't know about you guys can get mad about the mat all you want. I thought that there was one comment in there from name cannot be blank. Please secure one of these and do the slide drill with Vinny and Herb, and I will be a diehard immediately. So we just need I don't know exactly the price for a diehard membership. I don't know.
It's like $80 right now.
Okay, $80, but for a year?
Yeah.
Right. So I guess we need maybe four people to become diehards, and we would be able to then buy the sliding mat and be able to do that out in the alley. And we could test
it in the alley, but
whatever. We could test it with cleats and no cleats, and you could see if it rips it up.
I'm always game. You know,
you're always game. All right, we got a park close by. Vinny, you game? If we get four more diehards, you're game to try the sliding mat? I found it on Amazon.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. That seems safe to me. Right. I'm not, after seeing what happened with Herb in the alley, I have no interest in running without any protection, but the mat seems to me to be a protective surface, and I'm fine with that. I'm going to go shoes off, though. I'm going to go shoes off.
Yeah, I'm going to go shoes off first. Me and you can go shoes off first, and then Herb can slide in baseball cleats and see if it tears it up.
I got some right in the trunk right now. Some Mike Trouts.
Let's go. All right. And speaking of new diehards.
Always prepared.
He's always ready. Whenever a softball game's breaking out, Herb's ready to jump in.
Sorry, Kevin.
We got new diehards that have joined. Believe this. Jim and Tim.
Good guys.
Jim and Tim have joined us, so thank you to Jim and Tim for becoming diehards. You can become a diehard today at allchgo.com. You get a box, the box right here, with a free t-shirt, some stickers, a membership card, and access to our CHGO Discord, where you get to chat with White Sox fans, Bears fans, Blackhawks fans, everyone alike. We got a ton of channels, so you're able to really grow that community and meet some people that you might not have before. Let's get to the Pedro Grifol audio, and then we'll talk a little bit about Ethan Katz. Pedro Grifol, again, I think one of the bigger moments was how he handled Oscar Colás, one of the younger people, and I think it's going to be interesting for you guys to hear this 2 minutes on maybe the changed tone from Pedro Grifol on Oscar Colás. So here is Pedro Grifol discussing Oscar Colás' decision to not play winter ball this year.
For not playing winter ball, which is something that we all wanted him to do, I can actually say that it's okay. I can give him a break on that because he didn't waste his time. He is in really, really, really good shape. He's strong. He's athletic. He's saying all the right things. He's answering the questions the right way. He's in a really good spot. Now, part of all of this is execution on the field. This is the major leagues. You have to be able to execute, right? So he's got to go out there and do it. He's more than capable of doing it. Now he's got to slow it down and go do it.
He is someone, obviously, that you, Chris, everybody wanted to see him get things right in the minor leagues. If that ends up being the place where he starts this year, he's able to earn another big league shot, and I'm not talking just from a permission standpoint, his capabilities on the field, he's able to do that this
course.
Year.
Yeah, of course. I mean, the beauty of this game is the opportunity that's right in front of you. That's the beauty of the game. Like, he's going to have an opportunity to make the team. If he doesn't make the team, he's got an opportunity to get back up here. And how do you do that? You prepare and you execute. And if an organization wants you to play a certain way, and you want to play in the big leagues with that organization, guess what? You got to do it. And you got to execute. So we're never going to turn our backs from a talent like that and just say, no, I mean, he already had his... No, absolutely not. Players, I got taught this a long time ago by John Bowles. And he reminded me of this every single day, and our staff in Seattle of this every single day. Players are allowed to get better. You just gotta give them the time. Some take, you know, a week, some take a year, some take two, some whatever it is, but you never turn your back away, you never turn your back on talent. And you give them the opportunity and you teach them, and how many times you gotta tell them? One more time. You know, just like our kids. How many times? One more time. You know? And they'll put their hand on the fire and they'll put it again and again and again until one day I'm sick of getting burned. You know, so he's got talent, big time talent. You know, so it's our responsibility to make sure that we can get those little things right. But he wants to.
Vinny obviously chatted to Pedro Grifol. We'll get his reaction first, but Herb was pretty loud during that clip right there. What'd you make of Pedro's thoughts on Oscar?
You're asking like he's a child. I mean, seriously, like, he's 26. And he got better in the offseason where you guys didn't have supervision over him? Like, that tells me all I need to know. Like, you had him for a whole offseason in 2022 to 2023, pumping him up as the right fielder, and then he got to the team, and he was terrible. Then you sent him back down under your tutelage, did well at the AAA level, got back up here, and didn't learn a damn thing, sent him back down there. Didn't do the thing that you wanted him to do, was play winter ball, and just hung out with Luis Robert and worked out. So, to me, him giving sunshine to Oscar, awesome. But I'm not believing the word he's saying. They've already set the leg up on Dominic Fletcher. Like, yes, Dominic could fall short, but I think that Oscar Colás is not persona non grata on the White Sox, but they're just trying to pump him up maybe for a trade or something like that, because they've already sent him down two times. He's 26. Like, they're acting like he's some spring chicken out of high school. He's been here, and I don't know. The answer is good. I guess he's excited for him, but I'm not falling for that.
Yeah, I mean, I think the reason that Colás is an interesting player is because of how last year went, and certainly the White Sox have invested significant amount of money in him, you know, as well as hope. You know, I think that this is somebody who they do not want to give up on, that they're still hoping can be that guy that they wanted to see. But man, it was very apparent to everybody. You don't have to be a scout, you don't have to be a front office person to know that he was nowhere close to what he needed to be last year when he was struggling at the major league level. I think that nobody is expecting him to be, maybe besides Oscar himself, to be in the mix for an opening day roster spot. You know, I think that he will be playing at AAA for a significant amount of time because they want to see that improvement that they're seeing now from a physical standpoint in the game. You know what I mean? Like, this is a guy who they called him up from AAA and he can't pick the ball up in right field. I mean, it was jarring, the mistakes that he was making out there. They want to be able to make sure that that is completely out of him. And you're right, Herb. I mean, this is a guy who, when they signed him, we heard everybody talking about how advanced he was and how, hey, this guy played professionally in Japan. This guy, you know, played for the Cuban national team. This is a guy who should be able to draw on that experience and race his way to the major leagues. I guess he did from a timeline standpoint, but from a quality standpoint, it was certainly not anywhere close to what anyone expected. So I think that he is still an interesting story and a player worth following because, hey, maybe we are looking up in August and Oscar Colás has had an amazing season at AAA and Dominic Fletcher isn't doing so hot at the major league level. Maybe it's time for a switch to see if Oscar Colás can be, albeit belatedly, part of that long-term planning. But right now, in terms of spring training and a roster spot, Dominic Fletcher's pretty much got that job in right field. Somebody else is going to be the fourth outfielder, not named Oscar Colás. It's just, this is the start now of a new chapter in Oscar Colás' story. Where does it go from here?
Yeah, it still seems like Pilar will likely get that fourth outfielder spot. We'll see how spring training lets that shake out. But again, Colás only played 75 games with the White Sox last year. I don't think that's enough to really see what he's fully capable of. And also, too, we've talked so much about personal motivation. Oscar Colás got a chance in Major League Baseball and it failed spectacularly. We just don't think that this person's built like every or differently than every other athlete. Like, Oscar Colás isn't going to take his horrible time in Chicago and not try to build upon it. It seems like he's motivated. I don't know why Pedro Grifol would lie. You're mentioning about a trade. I don't know who's listening to Pedro Grifol speak and being like, oh, well, Pedro Grifol really believes in Oscar Colas. Let's take a shot. Like, he's only 25. He won't be 26 until September. I don't think there's a reason to truly write the kid off. They're not relying on him. Let's see what he can do. And if an injury flares up or something, we'll see what Colas does in that opportunity he gets. And maybe he takes full advantage of it.
Well, and I think, too, you know, we played the Chris Getz sound from Tuesday in yesterday's show. And I don't remember if we included the answers he had on Colas. But, I mean, he literally said, you don't give up on a talent like that. Like, the White Sox stance right now is that they're not giving up on Oscar Colas. I think it's just interesting to see where this goes. And it might not go anywhere higher than where it is right now. Or it might end up as high as Oscar Colas is the right fielder like everybody thought he was going to be a year ago. But it's just going to be, we're going to wait and see and find out what happens this year.
Yeah, in 54 games in Charlotte, 14 doubles, 9 homers, 22 walks, 53 strikeouts, a better ratio than his last, you know, 33 play appearances that he saw in 2022, where he had two walks to 12 strikeouts, and in the majors, 12 walks to 71 strikeouts. So at least that strikeout to walk ratio was a little bit better. He was still making contact. You know, I don't know how the defense is, but maybe this is a player that was making youthful mistakes and can clean this stuff up.
I mean, I know that Chris said that they don't give up on him, but in his acquisitions of Deloach and Fletcher and some in Pilar, it's not that they gave up on him. They over-recruited him. They like, oh, nope, you're not the guy anymore.
But, like, that's depth. I mean, you know, what's the issue?
But those guys are both young, and where's the playing time for Oscar Colas going to come from? If those same guys get the same straw or the same length as Oscar Colas got, they're going to be here for a while.
I believe they think Colas can play right or center, so I think if they're going to go with Deloach, I don't think that really limits him. I think that he'll probably play and get a lot of opportunities in Charlotte, whether it be in center or right field. Like, I don't think that this is going to be a guy that doesn't get playing time. Like,
oh, no, in Charlotte, yeah, enjoy yourself.
Mark Payton's not going to bump him off the roster, or our guy Rafael Ortega, you know. Like, I think he's got a true shot this year. We'll see. Anything else on Oscar before we hit a break here, Vin?
No, I would just say that think of this as more of a long-term thing, right? I mean, it's not, oh boy, they got Dominic Fletcher, that's it, Oscar Colas, go find a new gig somewhere else, you're done. Dominic Fletcher might not pan out either, you know what I mean? Zach Deloach might not pan out either, or they all might pan out, but Oscar Colas might end up the best. Who knows? That's what I'm saying, is that this is a long-term proposition for all three of those guys, maybe less so than we're thinking about what's going to happen this season.
Before you tell people about the beautiful lining Kugels, mm-hmm. but, I mean, look at where the Sox got Dominic Fletcher. They had Dominic Fletcher, the Diamondbacks. The Diamondbacks had Dominic Fletcher, Jake McCarthy, who's Alec Thomas, Corbin Carroll, right? Like, having a lot of outfielders that could be MLBers isn't a bad idea.
But those are all good people.
Right, but we don't. I mean, you, Zach Deloach is your guy.
Oh, yeah. Vinny
wrote an article at allchgo.com about Chris Flexen and also Dominic Fletcher. It seems like Dominic Fletcher is their guy. And then Oscar Colas, if he turns to pan out, like, hey, you know, it's gravy on top because, you know, they got guys to replace him in case he doesn't turn out. Tell us about Line at Google.
When our guy, Jim, our sales guy, told us that we, as the White Sox show, will be getting Line and Google for this season, I damn near fell out of my seat because if you know me, I think that nothing says summer in the city more than drinking a summer shandy at your favorite cookout or at the ballpark if you're going to Guaranteed Rate Field. And I know you're saying, Herb, summer shandy, that's a seasonal beer. What do you have for Line and Kugel that goes year-round? Well, I'm glad you asked, brother. Line and Kugel's original lager, light lager. What I'm drinking right now is called the Lakeside Cherry, the Juicy Peach, the Berry Weiss, Northwoods Amber, Dark Lager, and so many more. And as I said, I was enjoying a couple days ago some Honey Weiss, which is made with real Wisconsin honey. So you know it's good. And if you tried any of their beers, you know that Line & Kugel brings the flavor, whatever occasion. For 150 years, Line & Kugel has been combining German brewing traditions with Wisconsin innovation. You don't have to pick just one. Line & Kugel's popular variety packs come with 4 favorites to try and enjoy. Flavor life's simple moments with Line & Kugel, the official craft beer of the Chicago White Sox. Go to liney.com/CHGO to find delivery options near you. That's L-E-I-N-I-E linenkugels.com/CHGO or pick up Linenkugels pretty much anywhere they sell beer. Linenkugels, flavor the moment. Celebrate responsibly, the Jacob Linenkugel Brewing Company, Chippewa Falls, Wisconsin.
Thank you. You guys ever been up to Chippewa Falls real quick?
I haven't. It's in the Northwoods, right?
That brewery is awesome. It's one of my favorites. It's super awesome. Yeah, it's a great tour.
I can see it on the can. One of my favorites.
Yeah, it's awesome. Love a good liney. Love a good shandy.
Hey, maybe that's what we can do. We can go up to the Linenkugel brewing station. What's it called? Brewing station. What the hell?
Brew house.
Just a brewery.
Brewery. That's the word. No, that's it.
Brew house.
Brewery. And maybe we all three of us, Vinny, you and I, we jump in a canoe and we see how long it takes us to go from one side to the other.
You ain't saying nothing but a word. Linenkugel's flowing, I'm there.
Right. Yeah, thanks for the invite. I'd love to come.
No problem, Kevin. Thanks for the idea.
The Cub people will take you, Kevin.
Yeah, I mean, come on. You're wearing the Cubs hoodie. You're
I'm a baseball fan.
Oh, okay. Well, we're not doing baseball. We're canoeing, buddy. You're just extra weight on the boat. We want to let you know about our friends over at Ray Chevy. Ray Chevrolet is sharing their best offers all month long with their auto show sales event. Make your way to Ray Chevrolet on Route 12 in Fox Lake to join in on the savings. As one of the top selling Chevy dealers in the Midwest, you'll always be able to shop one of Chicagoland's largest Chevy inventories. Plus, you can find the perfect tailgating vehicles at Ray Chevy because they are offering 0% financing for 72 months on new Silverados with over 100 available. And to top it all off, they're pricing over 150 vehicles under $20,000. Seriously, can pricing get more affordable than this? Plus, since everyone loves the word free, you'll get that at Ray Chevy in Fox Lake, a free oil change. If you mention CHGO when scheduling your oil change, you can start off the new year right and schedule your free oil change by February 29th just by mentioning CHGO when you schedule your oil change with our friends over at Ray Chevrolet. Visit Ray Chevrolet in Fox Lake or RayChevrolet.com. They've been serving the community since 1963. Find new roads. And we also want to, again, let you know about our friends over at Gila River Resort and Casino. Chicago Spring Training Hotel accommodations are provided by our friends at Gila River Resort and Casino. Vekiva, it's the place for Chicago baseball fans to stay when visiting the Phoenix area. So if you're traveling to head west to watch Cactus League games or traveling to the desert throughout the year, call 1-800-946-4452 or visit playatgila.com, playatgila.com. Then, what'd you make of Ethan Katz's comments today on Michael Kopech, Garrett Crochet, and Jordan Leisure? Which one do you think were the strongest on a certain pitcher?
Well, I mean, I'll go through all of them there real briefly, but I mean, like, I think, Michael Kopech, obviously, all eyes are going to be on him, and what Ethan Katz said this year is that this year Michael Kopech showed up probably in the best shape, or is looking the best, I should say, in spring that he has since 2021. Now, remember, that was the season where Kopech pitched out of the bullpen and did a really good job doing it. He showed up to camp that year and still had some COVID, hangovers. Obviously, he had missed the previous two seasons. He still was not the normal offseason or the normal ramp up to spring training like they like to see. This year, he has, for the most part, had that. And so that, I think, is allowing him to impress the coaches a little bit more than usual. So, I mean, I think we heard the numbers 96, 97 from Michael Kopech here in the early going, and certainly Ethan Katz is impressed with that. Garrett Crochet, I think, got a good compliment from Katz as well, and they're looking to see exactly what it's going to take to get him to be that starter. It sounds to me like it's going to be really slow moving. Crochet, it sounds like, is going to start on Tuesday. He's going to be the first, I think, starter maybe that the White Sox are going to pitch in a Cactus League game, because the first few here are going to be mostly bullpen guys. He's going to start against the Dodgers, who I believe currently are beating the snot out of the Padres. But the plan is maybe just an inning for Crochet and then see how it goes. So I think this is really, and Ethan used this word, methodical. This is going to be a slow moving process to see if they can build Crochet up to where he would need to be in order to be a starter come, I guess, as early as opening day. But we're going to see how it goes. And I think they're really not waiting to make it, or they're not willing to make any commitments yet. I even asked, hey, let's say he doesn't make the starting rotation in the big leagues on opening day. What are the other outcomes? Because it's not like his career is going to be over. You can do something else with him. He can continue to be a pitcher. What is that going to look like? And Ethan's just like, it's too early for that. We're just giving him this opportunity. We're going to see how it turns out, and we're going to see how it goes. But like Garrett said earlier, Ethan reiterated it today, how the body recovers from one outing to the next is obviously going to be critical. And then Jordan Leisure, I guess we get another, one of these springtime hype ups. We talked about it the other day with Nick Nastrini and getting compared to Dylan Cease by Pedro Grifol. Now we've got Ethan Katz telling us that he was eating lunch with Andrew Benintendi the other day and asked who was the best player or the best pitcher that Benintendi has faced so far in spring camp. And one of the names that Benintendi said was Jordan Leisure. Obviously, the guy put up some really impressive numbers at the minor league level, both before and after coming over in that trade with the Dodgers last summer. Obviously, the same trade in which they got Nastrini. The fastball apparently is the most impressive pitch. We're going to see if it's enough to get him on a major league roster come opening day. I guess there's no rush with him because he is a younger guy, a prospect, but he's already turning some heads here at camp.
We're on the eve of games actually being played tomorrow. What do you think White Sox are judging and how they're going to be having their 26-man, especially for relievers? What are they judging? Are you judging more on game action or stuff that they do off the field? I know it's a combination of those two, but what's more important for the people who are making the final decisions?
I would think that I don't want to say off the field because, you know, it's certainly still performance, but the non-stat line stuff, right, is probably still more important. I would guess that that's how it would go. Certainly Pedro Grifol told us last year that kind of was where he leaned. Now I asked him again today to kind of bring that up again, to kind of say that again. And he did say that it is important what happens in the box score. It is important what happens in the games because, like you say, Herb, at the end of the day, their job is to play a game. Why wouldn't you judge them on how they're playing a game? But I do think that it's hard to put too much weight into that sample size, right? And too much weight into, you know, I mean, you look at think about a season, right? If a guy has one bad month, but five good ones, it's a really good season. This could be that one bad month. You know what I mean? So it's probably not everything. What obviously fans place a lot of importance on it because A, they can watch it on TV sometimes, and B, it's just something to see. Hey, Michael Kopech, for example, allowed X number of runs in this game. Ooh, that's good, or ooh, that's bad kind of thing. But certainly Ethan Katz is probably looking for what his pitches look like and what, you know, what he's able to do in the moment. With Kopech specifically, it's about, is he bouncing back emotionally and mentally? Is he able to get over some of that adversity? That's just one example, but it shows and it explains how there is so much more than just strikeouts, walks, earned runs, hits, that kind of thing. And so, yeah, get excited about seeing baseball being played tomorrow when the Sox go to Mesa to take on the Cubs. But know that if somebody hits a home run, it doesn't necessarily mean that, oh, well, they just want a job kind of thing, because we can remember back to a few springs ago and Micah Rodolfo and Yoelki Cespedes and all the other guys launching all those home runs, and then, you know, their major league play was nowhere to be found.
Right, they're just hitting those off of other minor leaguers, so it just looks more impressive because they're in spring training uniforms. There was a question that I was going to ask, and it left me. Okay, anyways, that game tomorrow, again, around 2 p.m., that's going to be John Schriffen's first game as a play-by-play announcer, so we'll be able to talk to you at 5 p.m. about that game and also Schriffen's performance. The rotation for tomorrow, don't expect Michael Kopech. It's Jesse Chavez, Nicholas Padilla, Joe Barlow, Frazier Ellard, and Alex Spies. So we'll have a ton of bullpen thoughts for you tomorrow. Vinny, anything else that we need to hit on, or are you going to go enjoy the Gila River Resort and Casino?
Well, I am going to do that, but I will say this. One more thing from Ethan Katz. He hyped up some of the names that we haven't really been talking about. A few veteran guys who are in camp who he kind of pointed out as guys who are opening some eyes or guys who have impressed him a little bit. Jake Woodford, Jake Cousins got shout-outs from the pitching coach. But how about this? Justin Anderson, who hasn't pitched in the big league since 2019, he was on the Angels when Ethan Katz was a part of that organization, so they've got a connection there. But Ethan Katz said that he is a guy that people should not be forgetting about, that people should be remembering when it comes to spots in that bullpen. So, listen, I think we've talked about how wide open this bullpen competition is. What's to say that a Justin Anderson can't win a spot over one of those guys that you just listed off that's going to be pitching tomorrow, right, Sean? So, we're going to see how that things turn out on that front.
Well, yeah, we're going to need to learn more about Justin Anderson, too, because Baseball Reference lists him as a relief pitcher, right fielder, and left fielder. So, hey, maybe he's got some versatility. He's one of those guys that bats left but throws right, so a real weirdo. I guess the other – no, it's
the other way.
Yeah, it's the other way. My guy, that's the Ricky Henderson way.
Yeah.
You throw left, but you bat right. All right, so Justin Anderson, not that weird, but he's
very,
got a
– very seldom you see the right-hander – who throws left-handed.
Right. It's only the weird guys like Ricky Henderson.
Yeah. And Ryan Ludwig.
Exactly.
I'm done.
He's got a good last name, though. We'll talk a little bit tomorrow about the bullpen. Obviously, the spring training game versus the Cubs. Maybe we'll dip into some Nick Nastrini as well. That's our guy, Vinnie Duber. You can follow him at Vinnie Duber, and you can read his latest piece up at allchgo.com. Also, on our YouTube channel, we got a short of today's recap that you can watch from Vin. He'll update you on everything you needed to know in a minute on spring training. So, again, read his work at allchgo.com. That's Herb Lawrence. You can follow him at HectorWall23. He's our CHGO White Sox community leader. You can follow me at Sean_W_Anderson. You can follow the show at CHGO_White Sox. Thank you to Kevin Wells for producing the show.
No problem, boys. Happy to be here.
Thanks for giving us the idea of the canoe, or we will not invite you.
Yeah, go up to Chippewa Falls, man. Have a good time. It's a great place to visit in the summer.
All right. Stamp of approval from Kevin Wells. We'll talk to you tomorrow at 5 p.m. Hit that thumbs up button. Hit that subscribe button. Bulls pregame at 6:30 on the CHGO Sports YouTube channel. Goodbye. We all silly like the mayor.